So, good evening, everybody, and welcome to today's session on Introduction to Marxist Criticism, reading Charles Dickens's Hard Times. So, today we have our very special guest with us, Dr. Prabhat Jha. Before we begin with his session, I would like to tell you a bit about Dr. Prabhat Jha. Dr. Prabhat Jha has done his PhD on the topic Conflict Resolution in Post-Independence Indian English Novels from PG Department of English, Patna University. He has also taught in Central University of South Bihar, Gaya, and Doranda College, Ranchi University. He also has a YouTube channel called Literature with Prabhat. His research articles have been published by Springer Publication and Authors Press India. His poems have been published in News India, Odd Magazine, Sunflower Collectives, and various other literary magazines. He also writes short stories and has written, directed, and acted in plays. He is the co-founding member of the cultural group called Graffiti and has co-edited two editions of a poetry journal, Collage. His translation work called Between the Two Dams has been published by Authors Press India, where he translated Maithili poems by Sri Tarananda Vyogi into English. His translations have also been published in Setu magazine and Life and Legends. So this was a bit about Dr. Prabhat Jha. Now I would request Dr. Prabhat Jha. Prabhat, are you there? Prabhat, are you there? Can you unmute yourself? Prabhat, are you there? Yes, you are there. I can see you, but I can't hear you. Yes, I can see you, but I can't hear you. Yes. Yes, I think this works now.
Hello, can you hear my voice?
Yes, yes, Prabhat, I can hear you now. So, Prabhat, welcome.
I won't be to able session. To hear your voice. So,
okay.
If you have to tell me anything, you can just write it in the comment voice. Just show your hand if you're listening to my voice. Yeah, okay. Okay. This is just a mic, so I won't be able to listen to you. So, I don't know, there is some problem. Let me also open the link in my mobile so that I can listen to you. Yeah, okay. Just add me. It's echoing. Oh. Now I hope it's fine. Yeah, okay. Let me start my presentation. Thank you. Hello everyone. Okay, just close it. Okay. Yeah, so let me start the presentation. I hope you can listen to me. Yeah, so first first let me start with introducing a few different kinds of economies that are introducing to you different kinds of economies that are prevalent since a long time. First one is feudalism, and before the beginning of the capitalism or the imperial era, feudalism was quite prevalent in England. And even during the time when capitalism was there in England as well as in India, we can see that although on the central level, the government was capitalist or imperialist, but at different states, for example, in Darbhanga or different states, Britishers used to give land, or people like Nizam of Hyderabad, all those people were having those lands, and they used to be the feudal lord of those lands, and they used to give the taxes, or when required, some officers or some army people, some army to the central command in kind of a, there was a kind of a treaty between them where the British government used to give them security that we are not going to attack you, we are not going to control your land, but you should be giving me some taxes. Similarly, in England as well, when Elizabeth or even later in the Victorian era, Victoria was ruling the country, Britain, the different countries like Yorkshire or different countries were given to nobles who were sometimes part of the royal family, or sometimes other people who were quite rich. So they used to supply army to the queen or the king, and in the expense of that, they used to get security. So feudalism, feudalism, what used to happen is a unit of land is legally given to a person or a noble family in exchange of military help by the state. So military would be given by the state, and the noble person or the feudal lord used to give them taxes and peasants or the crops, all those things. The state also used to collect taxes from the feudal lords, and there were also peasants working for the feudal lords in the field. For example, the word zamindar is actually a Hindi translation of the feudal lord. That was one of the prevalent systems. And then later, after feudalism although continued, but on the central level, it was capitalism in the beginning of the Victorian era. Capitalism was quite became the economy system of the country. And what is capitalism? Capitalism now is a little different than it was in the imperial era. So basically, capitalism is an economic system where the production and distribution of goods are controlled by the business owners, and the proletariat works for them to make the valuable items. So in imperial era, what the Britishers used to do is to capture. First, they used to go as a company or as a corporate entity, and then they used to capture those lands, for example, in India or Africa or in America. And then they used to get raw material from these lands. And due to that process, the production costs used to reduce. So it is a system where all those the control of production of a of goods as well as distribution of goods are controlled by the industrialist or the bourgeois community. The term we'll be defining later. What does capitalism work on? It works on surplus value. A company needs surplus value to be profitable. What is surplus value? It is the price of the product. For example, if we buy a biscuit, which is like 10 rupees in its pricing, that is subtracted from the cost of product. So if a production cost of biscuit is 5 rupees and it is sold at the rate of 10 rupees, the surplus value is 5 rupees. So what the capitalist system used to do is to reduce the production value or the cost of production so that the profit is more, surplus value is more. And what combines the cost of production? It combines the establishment, if you are setting a factory. Then it also combines workers' wages, minimum wage that is given to the worker, and the taxes, which is given to the government or the power which is controlling the country. So all these combine to make the cost of production. So in order to increase to decrease the cost of production, the wages of the workers were kept quite low, only so much that a worker can survive, just survive, not do well in life, but just survive. So that is how capitalism works. The third kind of economy or kind of government is socialism. In this form of government, the legal production and the distribution decisions are made by the government and not the industrialists. And it provides everything, every facility, like health, education, or different kinds of facilities to the people. It's not the factories which give you, or the private entities which give you education. For example, there are private schools and public schools. In a socialist system, every school will be a public school. For example, in USSR, which was in Russia, before 1985 or 1986, it was a socialist system. In that system, health, education, transportation, everything was controlled by the government. And there was a cap, only so much a industrialist can make. And all the industries are owned by government. And there was no hierarchy between the management system and the workers. So socialism can be said to be a stepping stone for the communist government, communism. Now let us try to understand some aspects about Karl Marx, who was the founder of Marxism, though Karl Marx himself didn't quite like the term, or he said that I don't believe in Marxism. But whatever he said about economic systems or history, that is what we consider to be Marxism. He was inspired by Hegel's dialectical materialism. What is materialism? Materialism is, it meant that the material world, perceptible to the senses, has objective reality independent of mind or spirit. So what we sense, what we see, what we can hear, what we can observe in the world is the only reality. And it is independent from the notions of mind or spirit or essentialism. Essentialism means something which is metaphysical, like entities like God or ideologies. All those things are not as important as things that we can see. Therefore, ideas could arise only as a product and reflections of material conditions. Economy is one of the foundations of one of the examples of material condition. What we possess, what kind of money we have, what kind of economic system the country has, it all comes under material conditions. So in his manifesto to the Communist Party, which was written in 1847, and it was first published in February 1848, he says that the history of all hitherto existing society is the history of class struggles. So for him, the history can only be understood by understanding the struggle between different classes. What are these different classes? In earlier times, when there was feudalism, these were the classes of feudal lord. One bracket of class includes feudal lords, and another includes peasants or workers who don't own the land. He also says that the modern bourgeois society that has sprouted from the ruins of feudal society has not done away with class antagonism. It has but established new classes, new conditions of oppression, new forms of struggle in place of the old ones. So earlier, as I said, feudalism was divided into two classes, feudal lords and the peasants, or the workers who used to plow the land and do all the work, or the physical work. And feudal lord used to control the land, give the wages and all those things. So he says that the antagonism or the class conflict between the feudal lords and the peasants continue within the industrial era as well. And he used two terms to divide the different classes. What are these two terms? There are two different classes in the modern capitalist system, which started with imperialism. And then now, even now, we can say in the neoliberal world, we have these two classes. The first class is bourgeois. Who is bourgeois? Bourgeois is meant the class of modern capitalists, owners of the means of social production and employers of wages labor, those who are rich. For example, the owner of Microsoft, or owner of Facebook, or owner of Jio, those who control the, like Ratan Tata, all those people are from bourgeois community, those who own the factories or industries. These are bourgeois. The second class, or the class which is in lower in rank, is the proletariat class. The class of modern wage laborers who, having no means of production of their own, are reduced to selling their labor power in order to live. So the bourgeois community were selling products, but the proletariat, the workers, had nothing to sell. So they were selling their labor in order to survive in the system that they were in. Now, what is communism? It is, according to communist writers and thinkers, the goal of communism is to create a stateless, classless society. Communist thinkers believe this can happen if the people take away the power of bourgeoisie, the ruling class, who own the means of production, and establish worker control of the means of production. It is kind of a, you can say, or people can say, it is kind of a utopian government, because there has been no example of communism till date. All the systems that have parties called communist party, like Stalin or Guevara or any other communist party, they have only been able to establish a socialist government, not a communist government. Because in communism, what happens is that all the control of the industries or the government, everything, means of production, distribution, everything is in the hand of the workers. All the profit is distributed equally among the workers. There is no hierarchy. So that kind of government is yet to happen. So this is what Karl Marx envisioned. This is something which he wanted to happen. So this is basically the political theory of communism. This is basically the political theory of Marxism. Now let us talk about what Marxism criticism is. So it is basically literary criticism, and in order to understand Marxist literary criticism, we had to understand what Marxism is and how it works and how it sees the world. What is Marxist literary criticism? It is a criticism, literary theory, like other different theories like feminism or psychoanalysis or any other theory, which has its base in socialist and dialectical theories, which believed in the kind of understanding the whole book or the text according to the economics of the setting or the economic class that the writer belonged to. Marxist criticism views literary works as a reflection of the social institutions from which they originate. For Marxist criticism, base determines superstructure. So it is the economic base which determines everything that is happening in the book. Studying the economic system to understand everything written in the text. Now let us understand the two terms that actually are the most key terms in Marxist criticism. On those terms, everything else in Marxist criticism, all the theories are based. These two terms are base and superstructure. Now, what is base? Base is the economic system over which the society is based. Okay, that is why it is called base. For example, in a house, base is the base below the kind of building that we see. Whatever is below the level of the land is base. Only on that the whole building is structured. So without base, structure cannot be made. Okay, so base is economy, and superstructure is everything else: government, family, religion, education, culture. All these things come under superstructure. The building is superstructure, and base is economy. And economic system determines what kind of superstructure we are in. If we understand the economic system properly, we'll be able to connect the superstructure, everything in superstructure, to it. So how is base connected to superstructure? He wrote in his work called Contribution to the Critique of Political Economy, which was published in 1859, that the mode of production of material life, economic structure, conditions the general process of social, political, and intellectual life. Everything, all those things related to politics, society, and intellect are dependent on our economic base. It is the base on which a legal and political superstructure rises and a definite form of social consciousness created. Consciousness of men is not determined by their existence, but by their social existence. It is only because of the economic system that we live in, our mind works in a particular way. Why do we want to go to the malls? Why do we want to buy certain things? Things that are produced by particular companies. Why do we want to buy a particular mobile phone? All these things depend upon the economic system. And our family, our education, the government that we are, the culture, everything is dependent on the economic system. Now, in order to understand the text, which we are going to talk about in a while, we have to understand the British society of 19th century. Because I'm trying to give you the example of Marxist criticism through the study of hard times. So in order to understand hard times, we have to understand the economic base of the British society on which the whole superstructure of the Britain is established, and also we can see all these things in the book itself. Britain was all powerful and self-sufficient. As we know that India was controlled by Britain, Africa was controlled by Britain, a lot of countries, most countries were controlled by Britain during the beginning of the 19th century. There was industrial revolution. The factories were producing the most goods in the entire world. Britain was the biggest imperial power. There was the production that was happening in Britain was much more than any other country, the way in America is, and now China is becoming. Britain was controlling the world, controlling the economics of the world. It was the most important country in the world during the beginning of the 19th century and even in the whole 19th century. During the second decade, corn was imported from outside and weapons were exported. The rate of corn became cheaper, the wages were also less. Feudalism weakened and capitalism became stronger and started influencing everything in the country. So the prices of corn reduced because corn was importing from outside. And because of that, people started leaving villages because feudalism was not profitable, or people were not getting enough work in the villages. So people started leaving villages and going to cities, industrial towns, so that they can get work, because industries were booming. There was revolution, a kind of a revolution, industrial revolution. So all those people living in the villages were going to cities, to industrial towns. The rate of, people were moving from countryside to town for work. In 1832, a reform bill was introduced where voting rights were given to poor people, but without power. They were given voting rights, but there was nothing in their control. They were not controlling anything. Several labor movements, including Chartism, started demanding more rights and better living conditions for laborers, but nothing much changed. This was called Hungry 40s, and the bourgeoisie always feared that there will be revolt. Only 60% went to church. Non-conformists supported democracy. So he says that kind of economic system or the government in Britain was that although labor rights were given to people, to the laborers, but there were a lot of demands in favor of laborers by Chartist movement for better conditions of laborers, because they were given very little wages. So that only for their survival, they could only survive somehow. Because as you know, as I said, that capitalist system works on surplus value. And so they were only given little money so that they can only survive. That is why, and there was a lot of unemployment. People were coming from countryside to the industrial towns. So there were a lot of people, and because machines were used, there was a kind of fight for employment. A lot of people used to live without food. And that is why whole 1840s are called Hungry 40s. Bourgeoisie feared that there will be a revolt. And that is why we can see in the later part of the lecture that they started giving certain kind of education to people so that they don't revolt. And about religion, we can say that only 60% went to church. So they were not much religious. Religion was dominated by science or industrial revolution. And as you can you must be knowing that Charles Darwin introduced his book Origin of Species, and there was all kind of doubts that were raised against the entity of God itself. So people were only thinking about money and economic benefits and not about religion itself. So 40% people were not even going to the churches, and non-conformists were also supporting democracy. Now let us talk about the basic plot of Hard Times. It starts with the introduction of Thomas Gradgrind. He was a retired merchant who used to work as a merchant, and he established a school called School of Facts in the industrial town called Coketown. Now the term, the name of the town itself called Coketown. Coke is the residual of coal which is used for cooking and other things. So as you know, if you have read about Dickens, he's not someone who is subtle. He's quite expressive in his presentation in general, in his settings, in his characterizations. He's quite bold. He's not someone who is subtle. So he used the term Coketown for the town that he is representing. In the School of Facts, which was made or created by Thomas Gradgrind, imagination was not allowed. And his children were raised, he had two children, Louisa and Tom, and they were raised according to that philosophy, where fancy or imagination is not allowed, only facts are important. He takes Sissy, there is another girl called Sissy Joop, the daughter of a circus clown, as a student. He takes Sissy as a student in the school. Later in the novel, Louisa married Joseph Bounderby, who was a wealthy industrialist and a banker, who was more than twice her age. Stephen Blackpool, a worker who was a weaver in the factory of Bounderby, couldn't get rid of his drunken wife because of the difficulty in getting divorced. So there was a divorce law, which in order to get a divorce, you have to go to the parliament. It was not easy to get a divorce. That is why he was struggling to get divorce with his wife. Then there was another character called James Harthouse, a wealthy, sophisticated man who became a member of parliament and wanted to seduce Louisa, who, with the help of Mrs. Sparsit. Mrs. Sparsit was earlier an aristocrat, quite rich, but because of some reason she loses all her money and has to work for Bounderby, first as a domestic house help or kind of housekeeper, and then as the keeper of the bank or the person who is controlling the bank. The hands, term used for workers. So workers were reduced to one body part because they were only using their hands in the cotton industry. So they were reduced, their names were reduced to the hands. They had someone called Slackbridge who wanted to form a union, but Stephen didn't want to have a conflict with the employers. So they want Slackbridge, people like Slackbridge wanted to form a union so that they can talk to their employers, people who are controlling the factories, so that the wages are improved, or lifestyle of the life of the workers can be improved. Although Slackbridge was someone who was only concerned about his political kind of growth in the society, in the city. So the Stephen Blackpool, a worker, he didn't want to have a conflict with the employer, because as you know, there was unemployment and it was quite difficult to get a job in the factories. That is why he was not that happy that there was a movement going on against the factories or against the factory owners. Then he goes to his kind of boss, Bounder Boy, and Bounder Boy wants him to kind of spy on this union, this kind the workers' movement. But he says that he doesn't agree with that thing, because he thinks of he has a kind of class consciousness. He says that he thinks that he cannot really become a traitor of his own people. And he said, he tells Bounder Boy that because of the kind of system that we have, we are, the workers are living such a hard life. That is why the novel is called Hard Times. And because of all this, he is removed from the his work. Now, moving forward in the story, Louisa wanted to help Stephen, but Tom asks him to roam around the bank to meet someone, and he becomes a suspect of the theft that happened in the bank. So he is removed, Stephen is removed, Louisa wanted to help, but Tom, who is the brother of Louisa, he tricks him, telling him that you should wait outside the bank and there will be someone who will meet you. But no one came, and he became a suspect of a theft that happened in the bank of Bounder Boy. Harthouse confesses his love to Louisa, which Mrs. Sparsit witnesses, but Louisa flees to his father's house. Harthouse is convinced by Sissy to leave Louisa. So first, Harthouse, who wants to convince Louisa that he is in love with her, wants to elope with her or marry with her. But Louisa, although says, tells him that we are going to meet in Coketown, but she flees to his her father's house. And then Sissy, who was someone who Louisa's father had as a student in her house, who was also helping his family in housework, she goes to a Harthouse and tells him that please leave Louisa, and he has to leave Louisa. Then Stephen is running away because of the kind of suspicion. Everyone is suspecting him to be the thief of the bank. And then Rachel is someone who is a friend of Stephen, and Rachel wants to prove innocence of Stephen, and that is why Stephen is going back to Coketown from the countryside so that he can explain his innocence to everyone. But he falls in a mining pit and he dies. But everyone comes and he tells them that it was Tom who told him to wait outside the bank, and that is why he is becoming he became a suspect. And everyone now understands that Tom is the real culprit, and he is someone who has done the theft in the bank. His family tries to send him out of Britain so that he is not imprisoned. Tom is not imprisoned, but Bitzer, who is one of the employees of Bounder Boy, he finds him out. But even then, he escapes. Tom escapes because of the help of the circus performer Slary. It is revealed that Mrs. Pegler, who was coming inside the Coketown so that he can watch Bounder Boy sometime, and she also befriends Stephen during that thing. She is thought to be one of the witnesses of the crime that happened in the bank. And she is presented to Mr. Bounder Boy, and Bounder Boy says that she is his mother. And what Bounder Boy did, that he tried to convince people that his parent had disowned him, and he was an orphan, and he was a self-made man. And that is the myth that he was creating towards everyone. And his lies were revealed, that he was not an orphan and his family was quite supportive of him, and he tried to remove Mrs. Pegler from everyone's sight so that he can introduce himself to be someone who is self-made. And he was only giving some money to Mrs. Pegler so that she can survive. Now, Bandobai, in the end, fires Mrs. Sparsit, and the narrator talks about the possible endings of the story, where Bandobai will die alone, Louisa never marries, Tom will finally miss his sister, and Sissy will live a happy family life. So this was a small plot summary of Hard Times. Now let us try to analyze this according to the whole Marxist theory. Now, what is the base of the novel? What is the economic condition in the novel? Coketown can be said to be a microcosm or a mini example of the economic system of Britain as a whole. Industries like Bounderby control the economy and political power as well. There is no strong leadership speaking for the workers. And mill workers like Stephen are at the mercy of Bounderby and can't afford to ask questions to them. Where he tries to blame the system for the poverty, he's thrown out of the job. So people like Bounderby or Harthouse were people who were controlling the whole society. And people who were workers like Stephen, they had no option but to walk according to the system which was running during that time, which was a capitalist system or industrialist system. And when someone like Stephen tells Bounderby that they are responsible for the miseries of the workers, he's thrown out of the job. So that was the economic system in which the novel is set up. We can also see most characters are motivated to improve their economic condition. Everyone is motivated by their economic condition. Bounderby doesn't want the workers to revolt because he doesn't want the benefits or the profits that are coming out of his own business. He believes that workers always complain and their work is not so hard. He had a typical bourgeois mentality where he thinks that it is him who is working hard and not the workers. He says that it's the pleasantest work there is, and it's the lightest work there is, and it's the best paid work there is. So he's thinking about workers is that they are always complaining, they have enough, their work is not that hard. Even someone like Stephen, who is a worker, can't afford to revolt against the system because he'll become jobless, and there are many people sitting without job and ready to be employed. Wages are low and people like Rachel survive somehow. So wages are low, there is not enough work, so he has to kind of work according to the system. He cannot revolt against the system. Labor unions have opportunists like Slakebridge who care about themselves more than the workers. So there was no strong labor union who were speaking for the workers, and whole economic system was controlled by the capitalist. So that is the base or economic base that we have in the novel, which is parallel to the economic base that London had. Now we will be talking about the superstructure, which is based on the base that is the economy, capitalist economy. Everything is influenced by the capitalist economy. First, education. Thomas Gradgrind said, "Now what I want is facts. Teach these boys and girls nothing but facts. Facts alone are wanted in life. Plant nothing else and root out everything else." So why were people like Gradgrind wanted facts too? Become more prevalent and not fancies or imagination, because that is what was beneficial or profitable. Emotions or things like imagination would create revolution in the society. So they were only talking about statistics. What does the economics do? those who are in the favor of government, they talk about statistics. What is the GDP of the country? How much benefit people are getting? How much loan people are getting? They don't talk about individuals. They don't talk about imagination, thought, poetry, because these things are not beneficial to the society, to the capitalist society. It is not profitable to be a poet. It is not profitable to be a writer or anything else, to be a painter, to be an artist. It's only profitable for them to be a worker, to be an industrialist. So these are facts. And this is the principle on which he brought up his own children, Luisa and Tom. And this is the principle on which he brings up all the children in the school. So he talks about silly jingles like Twinkle Twinkle Little Star, How I Wonder What You Are. Anything that relates to poetry or wondering or imagining, he is quite strongly opposite of that. He only talks about facts. So as we can see in this, the capitalist society of today's as well, we can see that science is dominating all the universities, or science is given more money from the government. Science is engineering and doctor or professors like medicine all these things are given more importance. Vocational courses, because they create jobs, are given more importance than things like social science or poetry and all those things. Because they are more beneficial for the capitalist system itself. It will produce engineers for factories. It will produce workers. Polytechnic is something which is encouraged. It will produce medical science. All those things that are beneficial. People are more concerned about getting a high salary. That is why everyone wants to, most families, most fathers or parents want their children to become engineers and doctors, because it is more profitable, a profitable thing in the kind of society that we are living in. Reading poetry was not allowed. Children would grow up to go into civil service or industries. That is the aim. That was the aim. That they'll go to civil service, they'll become, they will go to industries, they'll become managers in industries, because that is more profitable. Luisa was attracted towards imagination, but was kept inside closed doors. She is silent and cold for the most part because of that, unlike Sissy and Rachel, who are compassionate because of their lack of such factual knowledge. So someone like Sissy, who was not coming from that school, whose father was a circus clown, she was much more empathetic, much more had more feelings about people than someone like Luisa or Tom. Sissy belonged to the circus school of fancy, learning about fairies and dwarfs. She was reading fiction, 1001 stories. And but opposite to that, the son of Thomas Gradgrind, Tom, his only motivation was money. And he has no empathy towards people like Stephen or even his own sister. He uses his own sister because he only wants to have money so that he can bet. He is always encouraged. He was always living a hedonistic life. He wanted to bet. He wanted to enjoy life. That is why he doesn't care about Stephen or his own sister. Now, the other superstructure related to that is family. Marriages also happened according to financial conditions. Women in the society looking for financial security and ready to do anything for that, as there are not many jobs for them. Even Luisa or anyone, Mrs. Spartseed, all these people were marrying or doing anything in order to be financially secure. Even Mrs. Spartseed manipulates the situation to get rid of Luisa so that she keeps getting the financial support from Bounderby. Luisa agrees to the wedding. She agrees to marry Bounderby to help her brother as well as herself. because he was spending a lot of money on betting, and heavily in debt with Bounderby. And even Bounderby was looking at Louisa as not as a lovely creature or an individual, someone who he loved, but as Tom Gradgrind's daughter. It was the social status, the economic status, which was important for people like Bounderby or anyone, most people in the novel. Individualism in the society, because people were moving from the villages to the towns. The village societies mostly had joint families, and they were cooperative with each other. But in cities, there are nuclear families or individualistic families who only care about their own 2-3 people, husband, wife, and children. Only those people they thought about. So there was individualism in society, because privatization has individualism as a byproduct, because industrialists always thought about themselves. That is why they always try to have surplus value, so that they can get more profit. They were not thinking about society in general. Workers without their village family were vulnerable and were ready to do anything. Crime due to lack of support. So there was a lot of crime from the lower strata of society because of the situation of the economy. Now, culture, even the architecture of the town, the Coke town, was quite influenced by the economic system. Town was made of red brick, becoming black due to smoke. Canals were purple with ill-smelling dye. The streets were all the same. So there was a kind of darkness, or it was even the city, the whole town was like a kind of a industry, looking like an industry. It was blackened. There was no aesthetics. There was no beauty in the buildings. There were no streets having different kinds of architectures. They all looked same. That is how the capitalist society works. Everything is same. People equally like one another, who all went in and out at the same hour, with the same sound, upon the same pavements, to do the same work. Everyone was working towards the economy, towards the capitalist economy. Even the schools had the same design. Even the school that was run by Gradgrind was same. So there was monotony everywhere. There was no imagination everywhere. Okay. And even during the time of leisure, there is a quote from the novel. As they worked long and monotonously, the craving grew within them for some physical relief, some relaxation, encouraging good humor and good spirits, and giving them a vent, some recognized holiday, though it were but for an honest dance to a stirring bond of music. So there was no music, no relaxation, no good humor. They were culturally quite monotony. There was monotonous society. Everyone was only working towards profit. Even the workers didn't get any respite from the work that they were doing. Now, talking about religion, only 60% people went to church. As it is said in the novel, native organization in Coketown itself, whose members were to be heard of the House of Commons every session, indignantly petitioning for acts of parliament that should make these people religious by main force. So as I said, during that time, people were doubtful towards religion, and everyone was working towards the growing economic system. So they were not really wanted to go to the church. So there was Oxford movement during that time in Britain, which was launched in 1830s by Anglican clergymen at Oxford University, who wanted the spiritual renewal of Church of England and revived some of Catholic rituals which were neglected because of Protestantism. There are three books in the novel. So first, there was movement so that people can go to the church. People could become religious. Oh, you can't hear me. Can you hear me now? Yeah. So yeah, so there are different books in the novel. The first two books are called Sowing and Reaping, and they are taken from the biblical concept of whatsoever a man soweth, that shall he also reap. So Dickens was also someone who was talking about religion, talking about loss of religion in the society. So he wanted, he named the three books in the novel, and he related these three books to the Bible and also to the kind of agricultural economy which was prevalent before industrialization. So he was talking, he named his books like into three things: sowing, reaping and gardening. So he takes out the biblical concept of whatsoever a man soweth, that shall he also reap. Sowing, whatever seed is sowed in the land, that is only can be reaped after the growth of the plant. So whatever you do, like the term boya per babul ka aam kahan se hoye. So if you grow, if you sow babul, how can you have mangoes? That is what he talks about. That is what he wants to explain to the readers, that whatever you sow, you will be reaping that. And third book was called gardening, collecting. So after sowing and reaping, what is what the farmers do? They collect. So whatever you sow and reap, that is what you will be collecting. So he takes all these names from Bible and from the agricultural society. Now let us talk about another important term used by Karl Marx, which is called alienation. Term he uses that term in Economic and Philosophical Manuscript of 1844. That was published in 1932. Alienation from the self is a consequence of being a mechanistic part of a social class, the condition of which estranges a person from their humanity. A person becomes a commodity. Okay, they become alienated to the whole system, because a worker doesn't own the system itself, doesn't own the means of production or distribution. That is why it feels alienated to the whole social system, because he's just a commodity. He's selling his labor. He becomes a product. He becomes someone who is just contributing to the society, to the economy, and not someone who is controlling the economy. So he becomes alienated. He becomes quite alien to the whole system. Workers do not have to think of themselves of the conceiver of the product to be the creator of the item which is produced. He's not the creator of the item. For example, workers like Stephen never became a part of the production. That is why he never questions Bounderby. And when he says that their misery is because of the system, he is thrown out of the job. So someone like Stephen, who was a weaver, okay, if he had been in a village economy, he would know from where the cotton is coming. He would be weaving the cloth, the cloth on which the design will be printed, and he'll also take care of the design. So all that from taking out the cotton, from taking out the cotton from the worm, to making the cloth and then to print it and then to distribute it, everything would happen in control of the worker or the weaver. But in an industrial society, the worker doesn't know from where the cotton is coming. He just has the cotton. He just has the cotton, and he just have to weave that cotton with his hand loom or power loom. In the industrial society, we had machines. So he is not even weaving it from his own hand. He has a machine to weave it. A power loom is used. So and that is his only work related to the cloth. Then cloth is dyed, and then the design is printed on the cloth, and then it is distributed. The worker has no connection with any other part of the production of the cloth, the end product that we see. So he feels alienated with the product itself. And that is why he is also feeling alienated with the society and everything. So that is what alienation, by alienation, Marx means. Now let us talk about some other Marxist critics who had terms, who used terms related to Marxism. The first one was Antonio Gramsci, who used the term hegemony. What is hegemony? Hegemony is the power or dominance that one social group holds over the other. The ruling class first creates cultural norms and normalizes them for their own benefit. Then they establish cultural dominance to impose their worldview. The term which he uses is an Italian term, which is called Weltanschauung, which is in English called worldview. So it is the dominant economic power, economic system, which creates the cultural norms. For example, we don't read books, but spend most our time on Facebook. Why is that? Because it is a product of our economic system. It is much more of a global system. It is much more of a capitalist system. That is why we spend more time buying things from malls and not from the village workers, village weavers, small scale industries, because it is a system where big industrialists are owner of the whole system. That is why they have the hegemony. They have all the control of every cultural norm, everything which is related to food, everything that is related to our clothing, everything that is related to our creating our homes, the interior decoration, everything is related to the economic system that is controlling our country or any country. That is the hegemony of the dominant economic system. Education is used to project that in capitalism. Facts are beneficial and fancy is inconsequential. For example, as in the novel, Tom is a product of such hegemony. We can see people like Stephen and Sissy as well, who do not belong to the high class, also believe in the oppressive system that they are in. Sissy thinks that she's not a good enough student because she's not able to kind of adjust with the factual education that was given by grad. Okay, so she thinks that she has some lack of knowledge. The way people are, different people, painters, writers are thought to be not intelligent or idiots. Only those who read science are thought to be quite intellectual or thought to be brilliant in their mind. Someone who can understand maths, someone who can understand science, someone who is an engineer, is thought to be someone brilliant, is seen as a great student and not someone who is reading literature. That is a product of our economic system. Now, another important Marxist writer was Louis Althusser. He used two terms. First is ideological state apparatus, which means an array of social institutions and multiple political realities that propagate many ideologies. It has several branches: religious ISA, educational ISA, family ISA, legal ISA and political ISA, communication ISA and cultural ISA. So these are ideological state apparatus. Through that, ideology is spread. We are made to understand that this economic system is good for us. Through religion, through education, through family, through politics, we are made to understand that this economic system which is running, even for example in USSR, Stalin stopped people from commenting against his own regime. Everyone had to write in praise of the communist system, socialist system. No one could write against that. Okay, so through that process, ideology is spread in the society. For example, Mrs. Gradgrind, who was the wife of Gradgrind, she always became an agent of the ideological state apparatus of the government. She wanted her children to understand and to believe in the factual kind of education that their father wanted them to have. Then there is repressive state apparatus, the use of brute force, the basic social function of RSA, government, courts, police, armed force, etc., is to repress the subordinate social class as required, either by violent or non-violent coercive means. So if you are questioning the companies or the government or anything, you will have to either deal with some court case from the government, or you will be captured by the police, or through different forces, and you will be your voice will be stopped. You won't be able to express your kind of opinion against any government. That is how repressive state apparatus is used to suppress any kind of voice against the ideological state apparatus. For example, even in the novel, they were ruined when inspectors were appointed to look into their works. They were ruined when such inspectors considered it doubtful whether they were quite justified in chopping people up with their machinery. They were utterly undone when it was hinted that perhaps they need not always make quite so much smoke. So the workers were always forced to comply with the economic system that was in work. Any kind of revolt, any kind of thought which was against the economic system, against the government that is running, is suppressed by using of the police or legal system. Another aspect of political Marxist theory is given by Frederick Jameson's theory of political unconscious. He wrote this theory in his work called Political Unconscious Narrative as a Socially Symbolic Act, which was published in 1981. Political unconscious, to understand that, we can say that the cultural text is tied to an ideological political unconscious which underlies it. This political hidden background expresses a class conflict, which is expressed in the text in a complex manner. A thorough analysis of a text can uncover its political unconscious. So the books that we read have an unconscious. For example, if there are three parts of our mind, one is unconscious, conscious, and super. We can explain it in different terms: ego, id, and superego. So unconscious is our id, or suppressed ideas in our mind, and superego is something which we the kind of behavior which we have in the society, where we suppress our the kind of expressions or imaginations that are happening in our minds. We don't express everything in our society. And sometimes because of that also, as we can see, even there are quite a few mental issues that happen in the society because of the suppression of the unconscious. So he says that, Frederick Jameson says that, political unconscious is something which is inside the mind of the writer. And sometimes that writer doesn't express that in public. But if we read the text closely, we will be able to understand the political unconscious of the writer. A thorough analysis of text can uncover its political unconscious. He says that always historicize, always try to understand a text by historicizing it, by understanding the economic history of the work, or understanding the economic history of the writer. He uses the term ideologism, ideologism, or something which is kind of a smallest unit of the thought, of the unconscious, political unconscious thought that a writer has. Now, let us understand how we can explain this work, Dickens's work, by understanding the life of Dickens himself. He was one of the 8 children. He had very little formal education, but he spent much of his time reading and listening to the stories told by his grandfather. His father, John Dickens, was a poor manager who was arrested and sent to debtor's prison at Marselsea. He possesses his possessions were sold, and Charles had to work in a blackening warehouse. He was treated badly there. So initially in his life, he had a lot of trouble because of the economic system of the country. After his father's release, Charles went to school. Then he began working as a clerk for an attorney. He studied shorthand and became a court reporter and raised his standard of living. So later in life, when he became a writer and he started going to the court, he became much more comfortable in economically. We can see how Dickens's life along with economic system determined the politics of the book. He was critical of the bourgeoisie and empathetic towards the proletariat, but there was no revolutionary upsurge that he hinted about. He was more of a realistic. So he was a realistic writer. He didn't write an imaginative work where the workers will kind of destroy the economic system and there will be a communist rule. He only wrote about the things that were happening in the country. So he was a realist, but we can see that his sympathies, he was empathetic towards the working class and negative characters, as we know that his characterization is quite stereotypical. The characters like Bounderby or Tom or Hart, all the rich guys in the novel were not empathetic enough. And like people like Stephen or Sissy or Rachel, they were quite empathetic. So he was quite empathetic toward the proletariat in general, but he was not saying that we should remove this system, because he was also a part of this system. So if he had said anything like that, maybe he would have been imprisoned. So that is why in order to live a decent life, he didn't write anything like that. He was not radical enough in his works. So by understanding the economic system in which Dickens was writing, and by understanding the kind of money that Dickens had, we can understand the text. So this is my presentation. I have also mentioned some important books that are related to the theory of Marxism. Let me join you from my mobile so that I can listen to your questions. That was my presentation.
Well, thank you so much, Prabhat. That was, rather than simply talking about the theory or the text, what you have provided these students is, you have provided them layers of understanding by clubbing, these two things together, the text and the theory, in a very detailed, structured and organic manner. This was really, really rich. So thank you very much for that. Now I would request students, the guests who are here with us, to join with their questions. If you have any question, please unmute yourself and join us.
Am I audible?
Yes, you are, absolutely, Prabhat.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you for your kind words. Yeah.
Questions, please. If you don't have questions, it means you have understood everything. Now we can ask you anything.
I'll prepare a questionnaire then for everyone.
Looks like, yes. Any questions?
Well, I don't see any questions. Individualization is
Prabhat,
always.
Can you see the chat?
Yeah, I can
yes,
see.
Yes.
Individualization is always a byproduct of privatization. Kindly explain. Yeah, sure. Yeah, as I said, I mean, what happens in privatization? Where are the industries mostly set up? In the cities. So people who are living in villages, who are living in an agricultural society, they have to move towards cities in order to work in a factory. For example, people from Bihar go to Gujarat or Maharashtra to work. In their own villages, they have a larger family. They have a joint family. There are many people in their family. But in order to work in an industry, they have to go to some place. And they had to either live alone or only with their wives or husbands. They can only have one or two people in their family because it is tough to live in a city, in ghettos. For example, if you go to Dharabi or any other ghetto, you'll see that the life is quite tough there, much more tough than their villages. So that is why, and even for people who are in middle class, if you have to work in a company, if you have to work in a, say, a college, you have to leave your family in a joint family, and you have to think about yourself, your own self, not about the whole joint family. You don't even get too many leaves to enjoy weddings in your extended families. So that is why you are only living for your the few people that you have, for your wife or for your father, parents, only three or four people you are working for. So that the capitalism is kind of society which you have to be individualistic. You have to think about yourself in order to survive in a capitalist system. In a communist system, it's different. For example, in a communist system, there are communities which are taking, the government is taking care of everything. In a socialist system, for example, so you don't have to really think about yourself only. You can think about the village itself. You can think about everything. So that is how the economy kind of determines the kind of either you are individualistic or you are not individualistic. Any more questions? So can we say that alienation is a counter effect of this? Yes, absolutely. Alienated from the society in general, and also alienated from the work you are doing. For example, let's say a carpenter or someone who is doing a pottery. He gets the mud from the land and he makes the pot himself. Or a carpenter makes all the parts of the chair himself. But in a factory where there is a massive kind of production, one arm will be produced by someone, the leg of the chair will be produced by someone else, and it is assembled by different people. So the people get alienated from the society in general in their species. There are three different kinds of alienation. One, species alienation. We are alienated from animals, from plants, from everything in the world. And then we are alienated with each other, from human beings. And then we are also alienated from the products. So there are three different kinds of alienation that happen because of the capitalist system. Any more questions?
Okay, looks like you have satisfied the student. Any more questions?
Hello, Varsana.
Any more questions?
This is Preeti.
Yes.
I
was asked. Yes, hi, Preeti. Okay.
Good evening, Prabhat sir.
Good evening.
Sir, I have two questions for you. The first one is, I have always been confused between the term Marxism, communism, and socialism. So what is the basic difference between these three terms? The first question. And the second question is basically a concern for it's my concern about the global scenario, because socialism has been disappearing globally. All the issues that the Marx have mentioned, and as it is being mentioned in the novel itself, that in this time it has been recurring in contemporary society like never before. So there has been much debate around the failure of Marxism, as the social democrats also were were favoring to empowering the proletariat's groups of the society. So I just wonder, do Marxist criticism or Marxism or socialism give any solution to these questions or issues?
The first question, what is Marxism? Marxism is basically whatever Marx said. We can interpret them in different ways. His talk about capital itself, which he wrote up in Das Kapital, communism is a kind of system that was introduced to the world by Marx as well as Engels in his work. It is a kind of, see, what happened is they introduced communism to the society. They didn't say it is Marxism. Because obviously, if I start a theory, I won't call it Prabhatism. Okay? So, and for example, anyone, they won't call it by their name. They called it communism because it came with community. It came with the idea that communities will control the world. Communities will control the economic system or the governments, and not the industries, the rich people, all the people who are people in the country or the common people in the country, they will control the economy. And communism basically means that all the proletariat, the working class, will control the economic system, everything in the economy. What happens in socialism is that government controls everything. Government controls the means of production and the distribution. So what happens is that first, if there is capitalism, for example, in a feudalism, let me give you example of Russia. It has feudalism. Tsars were controlling the country. There were workers who were living quite a miserable life. And all the profits were taken by the jars or the people, the feudal lords. Then the revolution happened, October Revolution happened, because of the theories of Marxism, communism, as well as by leaders like Lenin. The revolution happened, and there was the Communist Party. They called themselves Communist Party because they wanted to have communism, which was the last utopian idea that proletariat will control the country. They established the rule of Stalin, and during that time it was a socialist country where everything was controlled by the government. Education, from education to industries, from agriculture, everything. You have to take the permission from the government for everything. But what Stalin did is that he became the dictator. He didn't go to the third phase or the last phase of communism, the last phase of the whole idea with which Lenin started his revolution, which was communism. He just stopped at socialism itself, a kind of dictatorial socialism, not even a democratic socialism. And that is why we can say that there is no, all the Communist Party were maximum socialist, had socialist government. None of the countries in the world ever had a communist government, although the parties were called Communist Party. And what happened is, because of their own individual For example, let's say Marx introduced communism thinking that people will be good, general nature of people will be good, but people were quite selfish, people like Stalin or other rulers were quite selfish, and because of that they didn't move towards the next step of rule of the proletariat, rule of the worker. That didn't happen. That is why that didn't happen. So I hope I answered two questions, the different questions. The Communist Party of the Stalin, or even in the in India, there are quite a few. Like for example, Nandigram happened, or Mari Chapi happened in West Bengal during the regime of Communist Party. Although they were calling themselves communists, we can give example of a good Communist Party also. Who were quite aware of the problems of the country, but there are opportunists as well. There, in the end, they were working in the capitalist system, and it's impossible to work as a communist party in a communist system till the time the whole world works inside the communist system. That is why they were the whole people like Trotsky wanted to establish communism in the whole world. Internationalism, because they said that only then all the countries will have communism. Because if there is the hegemony of capitalism of America on you, you cannot really work as a communist country. Okay, you cannot work as a communist country if the central government is not communist. If the state, then you, even in your, if you want to become a communist individual, you cannot become a communist individual, because the system is such like that. Okay, I hope I answered your question.
Yes, yes, Prabhat, sir, you did. You. Yes, thank you, Preeti, for the question. Any more questions? Any more questions? No questions.
You can mail me your questions if you want later. If I'm not able to think.
Yes, it happens. It happens because they have got to know a lot of things today, Prabhat. All thanks to you. Right, Richa? Yes, absolutely true. Brilliant presentation. I agree. The presentation was really, really good. And what I would do is I would share the PowerPoint presentation with all the students. Okay, there is a comment. Would you like to read that?
Yeah. First of all, I would like to thank you. It was very awesome and well presentation, starting from the economy background and the complete Marxist reading of the text has really given a clear concept of the theory as well as the understanding of the text. I have a question. What was the intention of Dickens through the idea of projecting the different difficult setup of the economic system? He wanted to kind of react towards the economic system that was prevalent during that time, because what can a writer do? He cannot really dominate the economics. What he can do is to make the people in power about the hard realize about the hardship of the people in society. So he wanted to make people aware, people who will include government, people in the government, as well as those who are reading. The reading audience, readers, about the hardship that is going inside the country. And all the characters are motivated by the economic system. So he wanted to represent these characters who are only thinking about themselves, who are only thinking, who are self-centered and not thinking about the society in general. And he wanted some change. Not a radical change, but some change to happen in the lives of the people. What we can do as a writer is to make people aware of the hardship of the people. If we're writing about the society, issues of the society. And that is what he wanted to reflect through his novel. Yeah, welcome.
Well. Right. So I think that's true. I think one of the most important reasons for writing, you know, is to serve the purpose of making some change or showing, giving voices to those who don't have one. Right. So, Prabhat, that was an amazing answer and that was a brilliant presentation. Thank you so much for this, you know, amazing experience for, you know, which you gave to us, to our students and to lot many, you know, people who joined us today. There are many comments coming up for you. So, we have recorded this session and we would be providing the link to everybody so that they can, you know, go back to the session and listen it carefully, then think about it in more detail and then get back to us with more questions and everything. So you're getting a lot of comments in the comment section, Prabhat. You can read it out. Thank you very much for this amazing experience. Thank you everybody for joining. Richa, thanks for joining us back today. We always love having you here. And many friends who joined us today, many students who joined us today. Thank you everybody. It was an amazing experience. Thanks a lot. Have a great time ahead.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you, Basa. Okay.